Our scripture lesson will be coming from the Gospel of Acts, the book of Acts, chapter 12, verses 1 through 17. The book of Acts, chapter 12, verses 1 through 17. About that time, King Herod laid violent hands upon some who belonged to the church. He had James, the brother of John, killed with the sword. After he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. This was during the festival of unleavened bread. When he had seized him, he put him in prison and handed him over to four squads of soldiers to guard him, intending to bring him out to the people after the Passover. While Peter was kept in prison, the church prayed fervently to God for him. The very night before Herod was going to bring him out, Peter, bound with two chains, was sleeping between two soldiers, while guards in front of the door were keeping watch over the prison. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He tapped Peter on the side and woke him, saying, "Get up quickly," and the chains fell off his wrists. The angel said to him, "Fasten your belt and put on your sandals." He did so. Then he said to him, "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me." And Peter went out and followed him. He did not realize that what was happening with the angel's help was real. He thought he was seeing a vision. And after they had passed the first and the second guard, they came before the iron gate leading into the city. It opened for them of its own accord. And they went outside and walked along a lane, when suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I am sure that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from the hands of Herod and from all that the Jewish people were expecting." As soon as he realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose other name was Mark, where many had gathered and were praying. When he knocked at the outer gate, a maid named Rhoda came to answer. On recognizing Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed that instead of opening the gate, she ran in and announced that Peter was standing at the gate. They said to her, "You are out of your mind." But she insisted that it was so. They said, "It is his angel." Meanwhile, Peter continued knocking. And when they opened the gate, they saw him and were amazed. He motioned to them with his hand to be silent and described for them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he added, "Tell this to James and to the believers." Then he left and went to another place. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
If it feels good. Thank you.
I won't go alone. Never go alone. Never go all my life. or watches as her sister is dragged away from her by Hindu nationalists, and she does not know whether her sister is alive or dead. A man in a North Korean prison camp is awakened after being beaten unconscious, only to be awakened and beaten again. A woman in Nigeria runs for her life. She escapes from Boko Haram, who kidnapped her. She will return to her community, though pregnant, and her community will reject her and her baby. It is April 21st, 2019, Easter Sunday, in Sri Lanka, and children are playing and laughing. They go down into their church's sanctuary after eating together, and instantly, many of them are killed by a bomb blast. These are true stories. These individuals, though they do not live in the same region or in the same country, they share the same characteristics. And that is, they are all Christians who suffered because of their faith. The persecution that they have experienced is not an isolated event. From Sudan to Russia, from North Korea to Nigeria, from North Korea to Colombia and India, there are those who suffer because of their faith. Their persecution comes from many sources and for many reasons, from Islamic terrorists in the Middle East to Hindu nationalists in India, to bans on religion in China and North Korea. When we read the headlines of these incidents where people are persecuted for their faith, their hardship or persecution seems so distant to us. When we read the headlines, we feel as if that there is nothing that we can do. After all, many of them are thousands of miles away. And oftentimes, we ourselves are trying to manage our own responsibilities and families. However, one of the most important things we can do to support those who are facing persecution because of their faith is to pray earnestly. Amen. That there is still power in prayer. It seems so simple, but it is what King Jehoshaphat did when the coalition of nations were forming and planning to attack him and God's people. It is what David did as he hid in a cave, knowing that Saul was coming to take his life. It's what so many other biblical characters have done in order to be protected by God. That is, they prayed. Because they believe that there is power in prayer. That while it seems like a simple thing to do, it is probably one of the most powerful things we can do when we are faced with the difficulties of life. There is still power in prayer. It is a season in Acts chapter 12 where the early church is navigating through some perilous and terrible times. The king, Herod Agrippa, the king of Judah, has gone forth to try and persecute, if not get rid of, three of the prominent leaders of the church in Jerusalem, Peter, James, and John. He's out to get them, and in his attempt to take their lives, Herod is continuing the hateful attitude that ran throughout his family. He is the son of Herod the Great, who killed all the children 2 years and under at his command when Christ was born. He is Herod. Agrippa is the brother of the wicked Herodias, who manipulated her uncle Herod Antipas into beheading John the Baptist. Herod was evil, but not only was Herod evil, Herod was also a politician. He did whatever he had to do to maintain his popularity among the Jewish people. He never saw a ladder he did not want to climb. And there's nothing wrong with climbing the ladder of life as long as it's leaning against the right building. Herod didn't care who he hurt, but did whatever it took for him to get where he wanted to get. So he decided to make political scapegoats of Christians in order to increase his standing in the Jewish public opinion polls. It's a sad day when politicians and people in power produce policies that are created by the crowd's consensus rather than the conviction of one's conscience. It's a sad thing when we have politicians and people in power who create policies based on how other people feel and to please them rather than through the conviction of their own soul and morals. The problem we have today is that we have politicians who have no morals. And because of that, they say whatever they want to say and they do whatever they want to do against the counsel of what the majority is looking for. They care not about those who are being oppressed, but those who are being impressed by the money they have on Wall Street. That's a different story for another day and another sermon. But Herod was a politician and he did whatever it took to maintain his status among the people. He decided that he would have James killed, and when he had James killed and saw that the people delighted in James being killed, he then thought to himself how delighted the people will be if Peter, the leader of the group, was arrested. And so he arrested Peter and had Peter destined for the same fate as James. It was a sad and distressful time for the Jerusalem church. Herod was in power. James had been executed and buried, and Peter was now on trial to be executed the next morning. Let me say it again. Herod is in power. James has been executed and buried. Peter is in prison, and the church feels as if it is helpless. But then there is a shift, a shift in the text, a sense of momentum happens in the text in verse 5. And I like the way the King James Version says it. In verse 5, it says, "But prayer was made by the church unto God for Peter." Prayer was made without ceasing by the church unto God for Peter. Herod is in power. James has been executed and buried. Peter is scheduled to die the next morning. The church feels helpless, but prayer was made without ceasing unto God for Peter. Let me say it again. Herod is in power. James has been executed and buried. Peter is in prison, scheduled to die the next morning, and the church feel helpless, but prayer was made without ceasing unto God for the church, for Peter. They kept on praying because they knew something about the power of prayer. Never underestimate the power of prayer and a praying church. Yes, sir. Hallelujah. And it seems
so simple that many of those in the early church may have been thinking that all they can do is pray, and that prayer, they should be doing more than just praying. That prayer, of course, contains your hands and your feet and your mouth. That prayer is an action word. That you don't just pray and not do something. You pray and get up and do something. But all they had at this moment, because they are afraid that the authorities are coming after them, just like they came after Peter and John and James, they're afraid, so they are in their house. They can't do nothing but prayer. And I'm sure many of them felt like they wanted to do more, but prayer was all that was needed at that time. Let me tell you, there comes a time you want to do something about your situation, but there comes also a time you have to be still, and nothing you can do is just pray. All you can do is pray at that time. Cancer in a loved one's body. Bills outweigh your income. The inability to find an opportunity or employment. A child has taken the path that you prayed to God they would never take. A relationship that you worked hard to keep together now ends bitterly. If your situation, your uncontrollable situation, is going downhill fast and your hands are tied behind your back, insert prayer in the paragraph of your predicament. In other words, take it out of your hands and put it in God's hand and watch God do something with your prayer. For if you pray, you got the keys to the kingdom and the faith that unlocks the door. When you pray, God puts on his coveralls, rolls up his sleeves, grabs his divine toolbox that says, hush, somebody's calling my... Sometimes all you can do is pray. I hear my grandmother saying, have a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about your troubles. He will hear your faintest cry, and he'll answer by and by. She said, if you stay there long enough, you'll start to feel a little prayer will turn in. And know that the fire is burning, because just a little talk with Jesus will make it all right. Maybe the problem is you're talking to everybody else but Jesus. And you need to tell Jesus what the problem is. Because when you pray, prayer gives you power.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Sometimes all you can do about your situation is pray. Two guards stand around Peter, who has been arrested. Peter is arrested. Two guards watch over him. They are chained to Peter's arms. Both arms. Two guards stand on the outside in front of the door of his cell. And then there are two other guards who are in front of them. And then two more guards who will replace their shift to make sure Peter doesn't go anywhere. My God. So Peter is chained. And though Peter is chained to the human eye, Peter is chained. Herod's in power. The chains are secured around his wrist. The prison is too fortified. The guards are too strong. It is very unlikely, if at all possible, that Peter will ever escape. And though Peter is in prison and scheduled to die in the morning, the text says that Peter was sleeping between the two soldiers. Peter is in prison. He has just witnessed his colleague in ministry, James, being executed and buried. Peter, is scheduled to die in the morning. But yet the text says that Peter is sleeping between the soldiers. If Roman soldiers, if you were chained to Roman soldiers, it is very unlikely, that if you knew you were scheduled to die the next morning, it is very unlikely that you would be sleeping soundly that night. But Peter did. The question is raised, how can Peter sleep when he is scheduled to be persecuted and die the next morning? Well, the answer to that is that Peter has been here before. This is not the first time in the book of Acts that Peter was in prison. He's been in prison two times before that. In Acts 4, he was in prison. He's been in prison before, and Peter knows that the God that delivered him before is the same God that can deliver him right now. When your situation seems uncontrollable and when your hands are tied behind your back and you seem to be going downhill quickly, remember how God's hand has moved on your behalf before. And know, like Peter, that if God did it before, God can do it again. I mean, just push the rewind button of your mind and think about it. This ain't the first time you cried all night long. This ain't the first time you've been broke and didn't know how you were going to pay your bills. This ain't the first time you've been sick. Think about it. You've been here before. And the same God that helped you before is the same God that will bring you through again. Because you ought to shout that you got a God that won't let you go out like that. Because his name is on the line. Yes, Peter was able to sleep because Peter's been here before. Some of us act like we've never been through trouble before. We act like we've never been through trial before. We act like we've never been broke before. We've never been sick before. But I dare you to push the rewind button of your mind. And you have to say, if it had not been, whew, I feel my help coming. For the Lord on my side, I don't know where I would be. Some things you got to look back and say, if it had not been for God. Peter's been here before. So he's able to sleep. And he sleeps soundly. Lord have mercy. Peter is also able to sleep because down at Mary's house, the mother of John Mark, the saints are praying for him and interceding on his behalf. The word intercede is the word, it means to stand in the gap. That Peter is in trouble, and I'm sure that Peter has lifted up his own prayer. But Peter also has people praying for him. And everybody needs somebody that can pray for them. Maybe it's just me, but there comes times when your burdens get so heavy, you want to tell God something, but you don't have the words to tell him. And you need somebody who can intercede on your behalf and pray and stand in the gap for you. But there are also those times that when folk can't pray for you and you don't know what to pray, you want to say something, but you don't know what to say. The Bible says you can just go, Oh, yeah, it's right in Romans chapter 8. It says that the Spirit bears witness with our spirit. And when you go, the Spirit takes your goes and gives your to God. God has the Son on his right hand standing there. God says to the Son, read this. The Son says, oh, I know what they're trying to say. The Son gives it back to God. God gives it back to your spirit. And your spirit bears witness with his spirit that everything's going to be all. They are interceding on Peter's behalf. And as they're interceding on Peter's behalf, they again teach us not to underestimate the power of prayer. Because while it looks like from the human eye that the enemy has all the resources. They have the king. They have the prison. They have the chains. They even have an iron gate to keep Peter in. They have all of these things. But Peter and the church are not lacking because they got prayer. And prayer is a bigger advantage to everything that the world has. For if God be for us, he is more than the world against us. That the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, through the pulling down of stronghold. That in the time of trouble, he will hide you in his pavilion. And in the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. That when the enemy comes against me like a flood, the spirit of the Lord would raise up a standard. God's got your back. No weapon formed against me shall be able to prosper. God's got your that prayer is the most powerful tool against what the enemy is trying to do against you. Two guards are around him trying to keep him under control. And so much, this text is so pregnant, it's birthing truth while I'm preaching it. And I remember the text lets us know that it is the feast of the unleavened bread. That when Peter is arrested, it is the week-long feast of the unleavened bread. But Jesus dispatches an angel to deliver Peter at the last minute. It's the night before he is scheduled to be executed that the angel is dispatched. Let me say it again. So it is the week-long feast of the unleavened bread. And it is the last night, which means that God had, you going to let me preach this or you going? Which means, see, I had a rhythm and a flow and you just, which means that there were previous nights that God could have delivered him. But God waited till the night before to deliver him. John Jackson messed me up, so let me say it again. It's the week of the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. It's the last night, which means Jesus had previous nights, way before the last night, that he could deliver Peter. But he waited to the last night. Sometimes it seems that God waits to the last minute, the last moment to show up and deliver us. Think about it. God sometimes does that, especially in times of crisis. We get upset, we get frustrated and wondering why God's not showing up when we want him to show up. That why is it that God shows up the last minute? God often does that during times of crisis. God, when God didn't show up until Abraham had his knife highly over his son Isaac, that God then showed up and told him to stop. When the children of Israel, Moses and the children of Israel at the Red Sea, God waited until Pharaoh was close enough behind them before he parted the Red Sea. When Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were condemned to the fiery furnace, God waited until they were in the furnace to deliver them from the flames. Sometimes God waits to the last moment in order that he might get more glory out of the situation. That God will wait till it gets as bad as it can get before God will show up, because God will get more glory out of it being the last moment, and teach us how to wait and depend on him. Just think about it. Had God showed up and stopped stop Abraham from slaying his son before he raised the knife, Abraham would have never learned that God can step in and intervene at the worst impossible moment and deliver us. If God had showed up when Pharaoh and his army were sitting back somewhere and parted the Red Sea, instead of when Pharaoh's army was close enough to get him and then opened up the Red Sea, then the children of Israel would have never learned that God can part the waters even when your enemies are on your trail. If God had showed up and got Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego out of the fiery furnace before they went in the furnace, they would have never learned that not only can God keep you out of the furnace, God can protect you and deliver you while you're in the furnace. There's something God wants to teach us through the mess and the messed up situation in our lives that will give him more glory. That's why he waited till Lazarus was dead before he showed up. Because what would give him more glory, healing a sick man or raising a dead one? Until it got as bad as it could get, God shows up, dispatches an angel, and tells the angel, go get Peter. And Peter is so sound asleep that the angel had to strike him on his side in order to wake him up. That's sleeping in Jesus. He was so sound asleep. Because here's the thing, God, and you need to hear this, God doesn't always deliver. God doesn't always remove the problem. But what God will do, he'll give you a peace that surpasses all understanding while you're in it. All right, so you can shout over all the other blessings. You can't shout over that. He'll give you a peace while hell is breaking out all around you. And everybody's trying to understand how you can be so calm and relaxed when all this is happening. But you know someone, that greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. You know someone. All right, I gotta end. The angel comes down, strikes Peter, tells Peter to get up. Chains fall off his wrist. And Peter, he says to Peter, now get dressed. Put on your sandals. And I want you to follow me. And Peter gets up, but the text says that even though the jail. The jail people, the guards there are unaware of what's happening. Peter also doesn't know what's happening. Peter thinks he is seeing a vision. He's unaware that God is delivering him. He thinks it's a vision, and he starts walking, and they get past the two guards. And they come now to the iron gate. The iron gate seems to be the obstacle that they will get to. The chains are off. They are out of the cell, but there's an iron gate. But the angel knows, and Peter learns, that there's no door so well locked that God can't open it. God, the text says that the gate opened on its own accord. And Peter and the angel walked through, and then Peter came to himself and realized he wasn't dreaming. And he said, now I know that the Lord has sent his angel to deliver me. I know I keep repeating myself, but you know, I'm a little slow. I failed the 9th grade and the 11th grade and the 12th grade and had to take a test to get out the 12th grade. So I'm a little slow. So y'all work with me as I try to repeat myself and understand where I'm going. Y'all shocked because I failed all those grades. Peter, the angel comes and sets Peter free. And Peter thinks he is seeing a vision. But when he gets outside, the text says, Peter says, now I know that the Lord has sent his angels to deliver me. You see, there are things that you and I have accomplished in life, and we think it was us. But if you look back over your life, you can say, now I know it was the Lord. Y'all not feeling me. That delivered me. I thought it was my education. I thought it was my good looks. I thought it was who I knew, but it was the Lord. I thought it was the doctor. But had it not been for the Lord, Peter gets up and Peter walks out, and Peter is excited now. He's excited, and he runs to Mary's house where the saints are praying, knocks on the door, and Rhoda, the servant girl, comes to the door, and when Rhoda comes to the door, and she asks, who is it? And Peter announces himself, and she recognizes his voice. She then gets so excited. She starts rejoicing that she forgets to unlock the door and let Peter in. And she runs and reports the news to the prayer group that Peter is here. And they say to her, you must be out of your mind. And ain't that just like some of us? That the answer to our prayer is right at the door and we don't even know it? That we're so focused on what's happening around us, we don't even see that God had already answered the prayer and he sent it right to our front door. Peter keeps on knocking, and eventually they let Peter in. And the text says they were rejoicing so loud about Peter being delivered because their prayer has been answered. Because they realize there's power in prayer. They start rejoicing so loud that Peter had to motion with his hand to tell them to be quiet because the authorities were still looking for him. And then Peter described to them, the text says he described to them how the Lord came down, sent an angel and delivered him. And he said, tell it to James and tell it to all the believers what the Lord has done for me. Now he says, tell it to all the believers, because remember that the church is facing persecution. Persecution was running rapid, and the people were forced to leave Jerusalem. It was a sad day, and so Peter says, tell the church so that they're encouraged. But then he says, listen, go tell James. This is James, the half-brother of Jesus. This is James, who is one of the pillars of the church. This is James, who will take Peter's spot and become the next leader for the Jerusalem church. Peter says, tell James, because James is getting ready to be where I am now. And I know that they're going to come looking for James, and they're going to try to execute James. They're going to try to kill James. They're going to want to persecute James. But tell James what I described to you so that James will know when he get in this position not to worry. Because what the Lord has done for me, when he delivered me, he can do the same for you. Somebody ought to shout, there's power in prayer. I said, there's power in prayer. That James is going to learn that God can answer our prayers. Won't he do it? Go tell James. Well, if the Lord has delivered you, if the Lord has ever set you free, if the Lord has ever healed you, if the Lord has ever brought you out of trouble, you ought to tell somebody that there is no secret. What the God can do, what he's done for others, James, he'll do the same for you. Anybody know there's power in prayer? Just a little talk with Jesus will make it all right. Power in prayer. Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
amazing.
You're amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
So amazing.
So amazing.
You cause the sun and moon to shine. I'm so glad you're mine. Oh, I'm glad to say you're mine. Tip joints.
You're amazing.
You're amazing.
Tell them you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Shout you're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're so amazing.
So amazing.
Tell them you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Shout you're amazing.
You're amazing.
Tell them you're amazing.
You're amazing.
You're so amazing.
So amazing.
You heal the sick. Raise the dead, you Lord of all, the great I am.